Can we go? All right. There we are. Whoops. I hope I didn't hit the wrong one. When one man, for whatever reason, has the opportunity to lead an extraordinary life, he has no right to keep it to himself. Jacques-Yves Cousteau. My grandfather, pioneer, oceanographer, and of course filmmaker, held the keys to opening up the undersea world to the rest of us. It's thanks to him, his 134 award-winning films and documentaries, and 72 books, that hundreds of millions of people around the world have been able to dive virtually in this fantastic realm. It's also thanks to him that the next two generations, my father and my sister and I and my cousins, have picked up where he left off. This year marks the 100th birthday commemoration of my grandfather's. And we are proud to say that we're on expeditions all over the world and continuing on in his footsteps. And instead of describing the kind of beauty and majesty and mystery that we see in our everyday lives on expedition, I'd like to take you on a one-minute dive. Now, thanks to Ocean Futures and PBS, we were able to also share our experiences around the world with people who don't get a chance to go out and see what's going on in our one and only life support system, our ocean planet. The oceans are a phenomenal place. Not only do the oceans encompass 99% of our world's total biodiversity, as opposed to our two-dimensional thinking saying 72%, but they also house almost 95% of the world's life. The oceans are quite literally the circulatory system of life. And as such, whatever happens in the ocean happens to us. Now, the issues that we're facing are very complex, but if we can compartmentalize and see the major issues as three systems, the changing climate, regardless of whether you believe in it or not, we are, as a species, emitting gases out there that create not only weather patterns and, of course, increasing temperatures, but also ocean acidification, which is a huge problem. The loss of natural resources, which in of itself is very alarming. And something that we're all here for today, which is ocean pollution, or pollution of our planet in general. Now, this is a wonderful little pictograph of what's happening in our Pacific Ocean. And although I've got to say slightly inaccurate, there are a lot of validities in this. Most of the garbage that we see floating out in the North Pacific, about 80% of it comes from land-based sources. And the vast majority of that, of course, is single-use plastics, the stuff that floats. Now, just to give you an idea of the volume of what we're talking about, the reason why I say it's inaccurate is actually the debris field is the size of Canada, not the size of Texas or three Spains. It sounds impressive. Unfortunately, only a couple of these areas are about 20 meters deep of garbage. Most of it is plastic soup, which is hard to see. Yet, even better news, unfortunately, is that there's a gyre in every ocean. To the tune of 2.4 million pounds of plastic being dumped in our oceans every single hour. So that's the enormity of the problem. As my father mentioned, we've gone to some of the most remote places in the world and been privileged to see the beauty of it. And unfortunately, we've also seen what human impact has on places that are thousands of miles from where any human being has ever been. Within 15 minutes, my father has picked up that pile of lighters on a beach stemming from all sorts of different countries. Here in Samoa, in one of the most beautiful reefs, I find a suitcase. Unfortunately, there was nothing in it. And of course, animals such as the monk seal are surrounded by our debris. Now, the things that we see are an enormous problem, and we might be able to address them fairly easily because we can, like Diana was saying, we can just refuse or reduce. But the stuff we don't see, or the stuff that we see very little of, is what worries me the most. Stuff that's impossible to take out of our water system. This is what gets into the food chain and ultimately what is going to end up in our plates. The flag bearers of the ocean's health, our apex predators, are some of the first signs of the suffering out there. From whales being entangled, dolphins, turtles, etc., being choked and drowned, to albatross, this one in Kure, last island on the Hawaiian chain, 1,200 miles from anywhere, where we see 16 pieces of plastic in the chick's stomach. We're losing about 1 million or so apex predators every year just to plastics. And that's just the apex predators. There are hundreds of millions of lower order animals, I'm sure, that are suffering the same fate. But what does that mean to us? I look at this, is a little collage of photos that I've found around, not just ours, of how we treat our planet, our one and only life support system. It's an alarming depiction, but I relate it to when I was growing up and my room. If my mother ever saw my room look like this, I would be grounded until I cleaned it up. Now, who's going to clean up the mess that's out there? We all have to. But more importantly, we have to stop the mess. Because beach cleanups are essential. But until we stop creating the mess in the first place, we're just going to be picking up other people's garbage. My grandfather also said, people protect what they love. But how can people protect what they don't understand? And that's the key. We have to start seeing human beings as the potential solution and not just the problem. We need to educate and empower and have us restore the health of our one and only life support system. Thank you.